Dear viewers, I am Professor Suresh Kumar, MS Ramayana Institute of Technology, Bangalore. Please subscribe to my channel for the presentations on higher education, especially outcome-based education, specifically National Board of Accreditation Procedures and National Assessment Accreditation Procedures. All my channels discussions will be on how we are going to achieve a better way of NBA ranking or NAC ranking. To this end, I am giving a series of lectures, presentations. You can subscribe and discuss. The mail will be presented in my mail is given in my slides. To start with, I am starting with outcome-based education, and lecture one is on Washington Accord. Washington Accord, why it is required, means to know what graduate attributes say regarding our National Board of Accreditation, which is important for us. For that, I am starting this one. Once again, I thank. Please subscribe to my channel. Dear viewers, my lecture 2 is on Bloom's Taxonomy. Bloom's Taxonomy is useful for accreditation. Bloom's Taxonomy contains two dimensions. One is knowledge dimension, another is cognitive dimension. To start with, in general, the students or learners are active agents. They will construct meaning from the information they get. They do have own strategy. Some of them have prior knowledge, maybe no knowledge to knowledge about that subject. So based on this literature, Bloom's zeroed on 4 knowledge level: factual knowledge, conceptual knowledge, procedural knowledge, metacognitive knowledge. As we can see in any example, if you look at a movie, audience do have different perception. Few audience may like screenplay, few audience may like action series, like that. Similarly, in subjects also, several knowledge can be acquired, like prescriptive knowledge, descriptive knowledge, conditional knowledge. Several knowledge varieties are there. However, keeping you of the our outcomes in education system, Bloom's zeroed on 4 levels. Factual knowledge, as I mentioned, factual one is factual knowledge, second is conceptual knowledge, third is procedural knowledge, fourth is metacognitive knowledge. In this lecture, we discuss those knowledge levels. To start with, we have seen Bloom's taxonomy is a framework derived in 1956 on single dimension. Subsequently, in 2001, his student Anderson redesigned, and they called it as a revised Bloom's taxonomy. However, because it is already 60 plus years, we call it as a Bloom's taxonomy. So a framework means it consists of a set of categories related to a single phenomena, and taxonomy is a special kind of framework. It lies on continuum. So they felt that similarly categorizing the nature, like birds, flying birds, non-flying birds, they have made an attempt to build a taxonomy for educational objectives. So a perspective on the emphasis is given to certain behaviors by particular set of educational plans. So basically, they worked on 3 domains: cognitive, affective and psychomotor domain. Original plans called for a complete taxonomy in 3 major parts, but cognitive domain, which is concerned of Bloom's taxonomy, includes those objectives which deal with the recall or recognition of knowledge and the development of intellectual abilities and skills. So basically, the idea is to transfer the knowledge acquired during his stay in the program. So the affective and psychomotor domain not to be discussed in my lecture, because they are not in the our line of achieving program outcomes methodologies. So basically 4 questions you have to remember for entire accreditation process. What is important for students to learn in the limited school and classroom time available? So any subject you cannot give 100% this one. It is a some semesters to have some time frame. maybe 3.5 months, 4.5 months, with minimum 90 days working days. Within the available time, the faculty do develop, design curriculum according to the constraints, and they have to conduct internal tests, external tests, so many. So nowadays teaching profession is a very challenging one. So these are the four questions which we are addressing throughout lecture. In fact, this will help you if you understand the philosophy. First learning question: within the classroom, how much classroom availability time, how much syllabus we can make, or how much students can learn. Similarly, that is called learning question. Similarly, how do we plan to deliver? So instructional question. So syllabus is over, our lesson plan. Then instruction will come, which is called instruction question. Then assessment or test items. So how does one select or design assessment instruments and procedures that provide accurate information about how well students are learning? This is assessment question. See, we designed curriculum, lesson plan, accordingly we are teaching, and testing also according to our lesson plan and curriculum. We cannot test the students which is beyond the scope unless some circumstances where Bloom's level 6 exist. Otherwise it is a natural phenomena. Entire domain subject we cannot keep for a given 4-year course. Whatever relevant for attaining the global standards of engineering education, that much syllabus we will keep. According to that we will plan, and we must take care that last question, alignment question, all these three, lesson plan and your instructional activities and your test items, all should be in a alignment way. So it should not deviate from this. This Bloom's taxonomy will help you to address these questions. So I would like to give you a glimpse of taxonomy table. Using this taxonomy table, you can design course outcomes, you can assess course outcomes attainment, you can program outcomes also, you can see that whether whatever you are teaching is according to your program outcomes given for that particular course or not. All this can be addressed. So the taxonomy table is arranged into rows and columns. Columns are cognitive process dimension, rows are knowledge dimension. As I mentioned, there are four knowledge levels: factual knowledge, conceptual knowledge, procedural knowledge, metacognitive knowledge. So to understand better understanding, in the next slide I will show you how you can see that your program outcomes or educational outcomes can be suitably arranged or suitably understand for our teaching learning process purpose. So you take one educational outcome, for example. See, if you are teaching at a program level, it is a program outcome. If you are teaching a unit level, it is a unit outcome. Session level, session outcome. Ultimately, it is the ability student acquiring or demonstrating at the end of participating in the teaching learning process. It may be a session, it may be a program. So one of the educational outcome, if you take, the student will learn to apply the reduce, reuse, recycle approach to conservation. Well, fine. Now what I have to do after I have written a statement of educational outcomes, in my lecture how to write course outcomes also I will demonstrate after few lectures, lecture 4 or 5. To understand initially, now first you underline what is verb. Verb is always a cognitive aspect, so it's called cognitive dimension. So you underline verb. Similarly, knowledge goes for noun, so you underline noun. Always the verbs encounter against a knowledge, right? Here noun is the reduce, reuse, recycle approach to conservation. As I mentioned, four knowledge levels here, six cognitive dimensions are there, six levels. So directly, because of verb is apply, it comes under apply and this one. So this matrix can be intrude. That means if you are teaching that one, he got the ability to apply procedural knowledge. That is reduce, reuse, recycle approach. So because approach term is there, I have not coined what is definition of procedural knowledge. My next lecture will give you cognitive dimension. So this is in brief of a Bloom's taxonomy. Suppose your course outcomes mentions that he gets the ability of this particular reduce, reuse, recycle approach. Now you are very clear, your course outcome is under column 3 and row 3, correct? So now your test item can be focused on 3. You cannot focus on other box, because you are not in the alignment phase. That is what I would like to show you the taxonomy table in my lecture beginning itself. This next lecture will be on lecture 4 will be on using Bloom's taxonomy. Very, very useful taxonomy table. You can experiment in your classroom teaching. Knowledge dimension. To continue our discussion to the actual point, knowledge dimension contains, as I mentioned, 4 knowledge sublevels. Factual knowledge, because in any subject we do have discrete isolated elements or bits of information or basic elements a student must know to be acquainted with a discipline. They are really required. So in this factual knowledge, again, 2 types of sub-knowledge is there. One is knowledge of terminology, another is knowledge of specific details and elements. Look into the knowledge of terminology. They are all the, for example, it's a technical vocabulary, musical symbols in music. They are required for the people to understand the subject, basic symbols required. So specific verbal and non-verbal labels, experts actually use them for the communication purpose, like alphabets, etc. So second sub-level of factual knowledge is knowledge of specific details and elements. So example is major natural resources, reliable sources of information. So basically the knowledge of events, location, people, source of information, etc. These are the terminologies which are agreed upon in a particular given subject. For example, in C programming, if you like it, it is a integer data types or floating data types, etc. So that is second level. Coming to the conceptual knowledge, we know that factual knowledge is a piece of bits of information or isolated elements. The relationship between them is the nothing but a conceptual level. So the interrelationship among the basic elements within a larger structure that enable them to function together. For example, if you take seasons, individually earth, sun, all these are rotation of earth, all these are isolated elements, but when they are connected, we create a relationship, and which ultimately a seasonal seasons happens. So there are 3 types of sub levels in this: knowledge of classification and categories, knowledge of principles and generalization, knowledge of theories, models and structures. What I would like to focus here is every level is a subset of higher sub-level. For example, knowledge of classification and categories is subset of principles and generalization. Principles and generalization is subset of theories, models and structures. So concept, basically, as I mentioned, they are all mental representation or abstractions of objects or abilities that make up the fundamental building blocks of thought process and beliefs. So they play very important role in cognitive dimension. And look into the first category, first sub-level of conceptual knowledge, classification and categories. We know that classification means it is a process related to categorization in which ideas and objects are recognized and differentiated and understood. Similarly, categories means it is a class or division of people or things regarded as having particular shared characteristics. Example, birds. In birds, again, we do have a specific case, that means flying birds, non-flying birds. So from generalization to we will come to particular specific cases, that is what classification and categories. Whereas knowledge of principles and it is generalization, it is a reverse. We will see that one later. So isolated elements form the connecting link here and among the specific elements. So that is the knowledge of classification and categories. They are largely a result of agreement and convenience by the expert in that field. So another subcategory is knowledge of principles and generalization. It is the ability to recognize meaningful pattern. That means you are identifying from non-flying birds to flying birds. There is a common pattern, sir. Birds, some characteristics are common. That is why it is knowledge of principles and generalization. So it describes the process and interrelationship among the classification and categories. You have categorized, actually classified your birds and non-flying birds and flying birds. If you are making relationship among that classification, it is nothing but knowledge of principles and generalization. So similarly, it is a relationship similar to bits of information. If you are relate, it is a conceptual knowledge. Classification and categories, if you relate, it is principles and generalization. Bringing together large number of specific facts and details and bring interrelationship between these concepts. These concepts generally, they are the nothing but they do not need to be related in any meaningful way. Whatever the conceptual we are giving, it is a need not be related in a meaningful way. That is what knowledge of principles and generalization. However, in the case of knowledge of theories and models and structures, they are with some observations, emphasis on a set of principles and generalization related to somewhere to form theory. Example, in knowledge, in biology, knowledge of theory of evaluation. So an expert in a discipline knows different theories and models and structures with strength and weakness of those. Again, if you look into the knowledge of interrelations among chemical principles, they are in a meaningful way that forms the theory, whereas principle and generalization need not be in a meaningful way. Next category is of knowledge is principle procedural knowledge. Procedural knowledge is first two, factual knowledge and conceptual knowledge, are for what we want to do. But whereas procedural knowledge is how to do something, methods of inquiry and criteria for using skills, algorithms, techniques and methods. Again, it contains three subcategories: knowledge of subject specific skills and algorithm, knowledge of subject specific techniques and methods, knowledge of which criteria to be used, when to use that appropriate procedures. So first one, if you look sub level, knowledge of subject specific skills and algorithms, we can see skills means it is an ability and capacity acquired through deliberate and systematic and sustained effort to smoothly and adaptively carry out complex activity. That means there is a fixed answer for the skills in a particular domain. Similarly, algorithm also a process or set of rules to be followed in calculations or other problem solving operations, especially by a computer. Of course, in either of the case, the end result is a fixed one in this type of knowledge. So you know that various algorithms we develop for solving the quadratic equation where there is a fixed answer. Similarly, another subcategory, techniques and methods. It is example is interviewing techniques and scientific methods. For example, you can have a scientific experiment for who is going to win these elections, and answer may not be a single one. The result may be few different answers, but their methods are different, and it all depends upon the results of consensus agreement on that, and not on direct outcome of result of observation. So for example, how to apply scientific method for different disciplines is important. For example, Q-line is not originally mathematics problem, but it is modeled as a mathematical problem, which we can call it as a theory, technique. So similarly, method, a particular procedure for accomplishing, approaching or something, especially systematic or established one. So a carrying out a procedure or technique or method need not end with a fixed result. It may be a few other result. The third subcategory is knowledge criteria, when to use technique, when to use appropriate techniques and method. This is most important because what situation technique methods are useful, student must be aware of it. So an expert recognizing the type of physics problems, apply appropriate procedures. That means F is equal to MA in his learning course, you would have learned F is equal to MA, but when he has to apply that matters a lot. So it differs from subject to subject for the students, right? So knowledge of which method to apply a particular solving algebraic equations, whenever algebraic equations are given, when to apply a particular technique matters a lot for the students. So this is the third one. Fourth one comes to metacognitive knowledge. It is a research one. It generally it associates with the cognitive dimension, because metacognitive knowledge actually it is a knowledge student to acquire that student characteristics. So assessment may be difficult. That is why majority times it is associated with create, and majority times it may not be that much frequently used in our curriculum, that means question paper. All these my talks helpful for you to design the question paper. Question paper, as you know, reflects answers by students, which ultimately course outcome attainment or program outcomes attainment. Okay, so metacognitive knowledge about cognition, and in general knowledge about own student responsible for their own knowledge. So literature, various researchers worked on it, like Branford, metacognitive knowledge, metacognitive awareness, self reflection, self regulation, etc. So we discuss only metacognitive knowledge, where it is having three subtypes: metacognitive strategic knowledge, knowledge about cognitive tasks, and also self knowledge. Strategic knowledge, example is knowledge of outlining as a means of capturing structure of a unit of subject matter in a textbook. Generally, faculty or students will see that particular unit, where to be start, where to end. So that knowledge of a strategy. So it is a knowledge of general strategies of learning, thinking, and problem solving. Student must acquire knowledge of learning, thinking, problem solving. How? If you recollect, student may have a rehearsal kind of strategy, elaboration strategy, organizational strategy. Rehearsal means, you know, that a given word or anything repeating the same again and again, terms again and over the time, it is for rehearsal, which is not good for engineering education. Similarly, elaboration strategy includes use of various mnemonics for memory, like summarizing, etc. So similarly, organization strategy includes various forms of outlining. Student transform material from one form to other form. You do have his own strategy of having maintaining this one, maintaining his own knowledge about transforming from one form to other form, like PPT preparation 1, 2, 3, 4, he may elaborate that. So some more maybe are there, but essentially what I would like to say, student strategy apply to learn the subject. Similarly, second one is knowledge about cognitive task. Knowledge about cognitive task, student again accumulate the knowledge about his own cognitive, his different cognitive task based on his knowledge. Suppose a recall task, it requires a person to search memory actively and retrieve the relevant information. Recall means some procedure we are applying. We want to recollect that what are the automatic operations to be incorporated here. Similarly, recognition means for a given matchings are like that true or false, that is recognition task. It requires only the person to see among alternatives. So students should develop knowledge about when and why of using these strategies appropriately. You should be aware of that. Then self-knowledge, it means knowledge of one's own strength and weakness, SWOT analysis of student itself. For example, knowledge that criticizing the essays in a personal strength, whereas writing essays is a personal weakness. Criticizing essay student may do, but writing means difficult. So awareness of one's own knowledge level, nothing but self-knowledge. That means student, sometimes he may be feel that I am good at writing descriptive, but I am not good at writing multiple, answering multiple choice. That judgment student to have capabilities. Please understand, these capabilities, strategic knowledge or knowledge about own cognitive task or self-knowledge, are essentially to be understandable by student during his 4 years course of time. That is why the assessment is required, a separate research to be is still being done on this, how to assess this from within the student. Some techniques are available but are not popular among the engineering education. Thank you one and all, and my lecture 3 will be on cognitive dimension, which is of second dimension of Bloom's taxonomy. Please subscribe to my channel for more presentations. Thank you.